Philippine Foreign Affairs Undersecretary Eduardo de Vega visiting crisis-hit Myanmar to meet with Filipino workers there. De Vega says they will determine if Manila can now downgrade its level 4 alert status in Myanmar, which was raised in response to the military's takeover of the government. Under the alert level 4 status, the government conducts mandatory repatriation procedures. But around 400 Filipino migrants there refused to leave due to fears of losing their jobs.
Ano yung likelihood na ibababa? Maganda, mataas po. Pero hindi ko sabihin na sigurado. Pero tingin ko, pagbalik ko, nakita na namin talaga yung condition, yung situation. Maaaring malaking posibilidad po.
Opo.
By next week, alam na natin.
The Philippine Foreign Affairs Department hoping to bring home as soon as next month 3 convicted Filipinos who were granted pardon in the United Arab Emirates. 2 of those Filipinos were saved from death row. The DFA says the pardoned Filipinos will receive government assistance to help them start over when they return to the Philippines.
Wala po tayong definite time frame, but we're hoping in the next month or so, ayusin na yung kanilang mga papeles at na makauwi na, even less than that. Again, marami namin naman tayo mga kababayan ang napardon na sa UAE in the past, and usually it takes about a month or even less bago sila mapauwi talaga dito sa Pilipinas.
The DFA also disclosed a number of Filipinos remain in jail in the UAE for a range of criminal cases such as drug trafficking, theft, and murder. It assures the public legal assistance is being provided to them. The Philippine Senate President denies claims of tampering with a controversial measure to create a national investment fund. Senator Juan Miguel Zubiri says the updated version of the Maharlika Investment Fund bill he signed while in the U.S. only meant to reflect what senators had earlier agreed upon when they passed the measure on third and final reading. Critics have assailed Zubiri's move and urged him to send the bill back to Congress to deliberate on the changes. The Senate leader admits it was an oversight on the part of the chamber staff.
Unang-una, there's no such thing as tampering. There was never a plan to tamper. There was no sinister move to tamper the measure. There was no tampering that took place. We just want to put on record that we just reflected the true intention. Let me repeat. The true intention of the provisions as reflected on the transcript of records. After checking the draft, we saw that there was inconsistencies on Section 50 and 51, which I actually, to be honest about it, was an honest oversight by the staff. Okay, honest oversight by the secretariat and the staff of Senator Villar.
President Marcos set to mark his first year in office Friday. He describes his administration's performance so far as a work in progress. Marcos also admitting he has yet to fulfill his campaign promises a year into his presidency.
This is an ongoing process. Again, we have to bear in mind that the international situation has changed in terms of trade, in terms of geopolitics, and so we are having to adjust to that. And now it is very clear that the most successful economies were those who are agile and resilient.
As for his performance as the country's agriculture secretary, this is how Marcos is grading himself.
I saw a report earlier this morning where one of the economists said the grade that I will give the president for agriculture is incomplete. I agree with him. We are not yet done. Ang dami pa nating gagawin. There are many, many things that we still need to do. We have to undo 30, 35, almost 40 years of neglect when it comes to the agricultural sector. And the agricultural sector still occupies the most fundamental part of our economy. And so, yes, we have done a lot of work. I think we have seen this many of the changes. We are beginning to see the systemic changes that are going to be part of the new bureaucracy. But there's still a long way to go. It's never enough. Whatever it is that we have managed to do, there is still a great deal more to do. We have a lot of work still to do, and we have to work smart, and we have to work well, and we have to be very conscious.
Now, President Marcos made history when he took on the role of Philippine Agriculture Secretary. In his 1 year in office, he has already faced several issues in the agri sector, including questions over his campaign promise of bringing down the price of rice. Jervis Manahan with this special report.
A few days before assuming the presidency, then President-elect Ferdinand Marcos Jr. announced that he will take on the portfolio of Agriculture Secretary.
I think that the problem is severe enough that I have decided to take on the portfolio of Secretary of Agriculture, at least for now.
He is the first president in Philippine history to assume the post. Marcos ran his campaign with the promise of lowering the price of rice to 20 pesos per kilo, revitalizing the Kadiwa program, and reviving the Masagana program of his late father. These promises convinced Mang Domingo, a farmer in Giginto, Bulacan, to support Marcos Jr.
Ayun na ba, ang gamit sa bukid, napakamahal. Paano naman namin maibibinta ang aming palay? Sana na lang magkano na lang mabibili, di ba? Sana, magkakaat pa paano. Kung ano naman, tasa naman ang presyo ng lalo sa palay.
Upon assuming office, Marcos Jr.'s first marching order to the department was to increase local production of major commodities to uplift the lives of farmers and fisher folk. But only months into his presidency, several issues started hounding the department, such as the controversial sugar importation program, which the palace itself called illegal.
Importation plan.
This fiasco resulted to the resignation of the officials of the Sugar Regulatory Administration. The importation eventually pushed through, although with a considerably less volume than the original imports. The problems didn't end there. Another batch of sugar imports done earlier this year was also marred with controversy. Because of seemingly handpicked importers and an irregular timeline of arrival, Senator Risa Hontiveros called it a state-sponsored smuggling.
Pag pinayagan natin ang asukal na pasukin ng mga kartel, pinapayagan natin na kontrolin nila ang presyo nito.
An investigation was launched by the Senate Blue Ribbon Committee, where DA Senior Undersecretary Domingo Panganiban, a Marcos appointee, explained his actions.
I acted with haste and interpreted the memorandum issued by the Office of the Executive Secretary as an approval to proceed with the importation.
Aside from sugar, another commodity became a major problem: onions. Prices of onions soared at the tail end of 2022, rising to as high as 700 pesos per kilo. The department was left with no choice but import at the start of this year. This received criticism from local onion stakeholders as harvest season was going to kick in.
Paano naman hindi tayo kailangan mag-import? Tignan mo yung production ng Pilipinas, tignan mo yung demand, malayo talaga. Sinubukan natin na makuha lahat ng mga smuggled pero kulang pa rin.
There were also some other issues, such as the dwindling rice buffer stock of the National Food Authority, destruction of crops during typhoons, and the seemingly endless stream of smuggled agricultural products in our ports. An agricultural analyst believes that 1 year in, food inflation remains to be the biggest agricultural challenge of the Marcos administration.
When you look at the Philippine budget, the household income, 40% of that for the average Filipino household goes to food.
Ilagan says aside from food inflation and smuggling, animal diseases like avian influenza and African swine fever will also be persisting problem the Marcos admin will have to face in the future. But there were some positive developments as well, such as a bigger agency budget.
Having those additional resources obviously means the possibility to spend more for improved productivity.
Marcos, being the Agriculture Secretary, also made it easier to pass policies such as the easing of some tariffs, including on corn. But for Rice Monitoring Group Bantay Bigas, what they saw in the first year of the Marcos administration was nothing but empty promises.
Hanggang ngayon, wala tayong naaaninag na 20 pesos per kilo, bagkus ay napakataas, tumaas nang tumaas ang presyo ng bigas.
The Department of Agriculture maintains that despite the challenges, the agency remains focused on achieving Marcos's mandate, food security.
We are trying our best, no, with the president as our secretary. Maraming pagbabago on the food security, no, yung ating pong tinututukan palagi.
The department has already expanded Kadiwa outlets to make affordable food accessible to more Filipinos. It will also continue to focus on increasing productivity in major commodities such as rice. For Mang Domingo, his life hasn't changed much in the past year, but he hasn't given up hope yet.
Sana magsasaka, matulungan niya. Kalimitan sa yung mahal ng pataba, gamot, yung mga fertilizer na yan, tapos yung sa gamot ng ano, yun ang nag-aano dito, mahal, matatumataas.
He's still waiting to see if the Marcos administration will fulfill its promises. Jervis Manahan, ABS-CBN News.
President Marcos denying the Philippine government already has a deal with the U.S. to temporarily host Afghans in the country. He says they are still exploring options for housing Afghans displaced by the turmoil in their country. The president's sister, Senator Amy Marcos, was among the first ones to raise security concerns over the request.
I was a little surprised when I saw some of the news reports. There is a deal between the U.S. There's no deal. We're still looking exactly at how to make it work if we can. It's entirely possible that we will not find a way to make it happen. But we have a long tradition in the Philippines of taking in refugees, although these are not refugees. They are an entirely different class of person. They are Afghan nationals who are being resettled by the United States in the United States and or other places. There are security issues. We have to be conscious of that, but there are even more difficult legal and logistical issues.
Philippine Ambassador to the U.S. Jose Manuel Romualdez earlier said the palace has until mid-July to make a decision on Washington's request.